to raise your hand. You don't have to shout out your answer, but I need you to give an answer. Because that's how we're going to work together. And that's how we're going to remember things. Amen. Can we do that? I got up this morning very early, and one of the symptoms that I do get once in a while is a stomach. And this morning it was one of those mornings. And I decided for myself, I'm not going to make a fuss about this. Because if I'm not wrong, each and every organ in our bodies, everything alive, if I can say that, has an ear. Am I right? Everything has an ear. And this morning I spoke and I said to my stomach, you will behave today. You will behave today. You are healed. This is only part of, but you will not. There's no excuses for today. And since I've spoken to right now, everything is calm, everything is smooth. And I want to say this morning to Martins. So Martins, jy het vir my so gemaak toe ek inkom. Ons sê vanoggend vir daai hoes, vir daai keel, gaan. Jy het nie plek nie. Nee, nie die huis nie, nee, nie die liggaam nie. Each and every one of you that's here this morning that's got symptoms of a flu, they call it so many. Lately I hear it's a pig. A pig has got the blame for the flu. A swine. I want to say to you this morning, if there's something that's troubling this morning, speak to it. Speak to it. It's got an ear. It has to listen to you. If you take the authority, we sang just now, the moisten name. If you use that name, if you speak under the authority of that name, it has to listen to you. Speak to it. Speak to it. I want to start this morning with a question. I've got a few questions, but I want to start with this question this morning. Who of you here this morning is a Timothy? A Timothy. Who of you this morning sitting here can call yourself a Timothy? Or if I have to put it in another word this morning, who of you this morning can call yourself a disciple of Jesus? But now I want to ask you, why don't you call yourself Timothy's? You see, Timothy and disciples is one and the same thing. They serve. They serve. We just heard when Prophet was speaking to us now. You know, it's good to do, it's good to be part. But if you don't do anything, you just be being part. Timothy and disciples were not just being part, they served. Why do I want to start with this question this morning? Why did I raise this question? And why did I ask you to answer this question this morning? Most of you raised your hands and I'm grateful for that. You know, you don't answer me, you answer for yourself. Because Timothy was not the undercover agent. The disciples were not given an assignment to do in the secret. The assignment that they received was to go. How many of us this morning can stand on that we are going, that we are busy doing? I really thought Prophet had somewhere got a hold of my notes this morning for this morning, because when he said you cannot expect a reward if you're not doing, that is what this morning is about. Read with me Matthew 4 verse 19 and 20. Thank you, Scotty, for helping me today. And he said to them, come after me as disciples, letting me be your guide. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. At once they left their nets and became his disciples, sided with his party, and followed him. Just as in our country, you know how many different parties there is? But there's only one valid party, and that's his party. We all know that with a request, there is a choice. With a request, you can choose to do or not to do. But a commandment is different. A command is different from a request. Jesus commanded them, stand up and follow me. The very same assignment was given to us. Born again, sons and daughters of God, when we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior, just like Timothy and just like the disciples. Mark 16 verse 15 says, and he said to them, go into all the world and preach and publish openly the good news, the gospel, to every creature of the whole human race. There's a problem here. Many of us don't understand this script correctly. Because we want to preach the gospel, we want to give the good news, we want to openly declare to the people sitting here this morning. But at work, we're undercover agents. But at work, nobody hears me speaking about him. At work, sometimes it feels like the people of the world is mentioning him more every day, every moment, by using his name than me. To which party then do I belong? You see, this is things that I need to speak to you about this morning. As you see where I'm going, you'll understand. But to which party do you belong? As sons and daughters of God Almighty, we are equipped Sunday after Sunday with every prayer meeting that we attend, every home group that we attend. We are equipped to do what Jesus called us to do. I don't understand why it is that when we're out of the family, when we're out of here, we're all quiet. I'm not saying everybody, please understand me. But if you listen to the majority of Christians today, they are quiet. They don't say things. You know, I don't want to offend. If we look at what happened now at the Olympics. But when Jesus is offended, the Christians are quiet. I don't want to be offended. I don't want to offend you. To which party do we belong? In our personal Bible study time, we are equipped in our prayer time to go out and preach, to give the good news, to be a witness of God's goodness, of his faithfulness, but most importantly, of his love for everybody, his love for all. And this is where the topic of this morning began, the reward. Do you believe that there's a reward? I want to ask you, is that reward that you believe in, that reward, is that a one day reward? One day even in heaven reward? No. We are rewarded each and every day. As we do, we are rewarded. As we give, we are rewarded. Read with me 1 Corinthians 15 verse 8. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be firm, steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, always being superior, excelling, doing more than enough in the service of the Lord. You see, doing, it's an act. Knowing and being continually aware that your labor in the Lord is not futile. It's never wasted or to no purpose. You know what this says to me? What I read from this, that your labor in the Lord is not futile, it's never wasted or to no purpose. It says to me there's a reward. As you do, there's a reward. As you speak, there's a reward. But from which part is the reward coming? Reading the whole letter Paul wrote to the church in Corinth, he focused on the victory that comes through Jesus. I've got one amen this morning. It's either we're not listening or we're not sure. There's only one name from where our victory comes from, and that's Jesus. I'm giving a shout out this morning because I got to a place where I saw this physically in my life. Victory comes through Jesus. Victory comes from Jesus. The Bible is very clear about it. Jesus' death not only took care of the sin issue, Jesus defeated the power of sin. Meaning that the life that we ought to live is that of abundance, that of victory, by the power of the Holy Spirit that lives within us. Because of what Jesus did, God is rewarding us, me and you, with abundance. Wow! What Jesus did, God is awarding us with victories. But there's a but to this. But many are missing this. And the question that I asked myself, why? Why do I say many are missing this? Because many Christians became ambassadors for camouflaged companies. Many Christians say something, but they do differently. Many Christians will say on a Sunday the holiest of the holiest things, but come Monday to Friday at work, they live a different lifestyle. How can you be rewarded for that? But yet at the end of the day, we want the reward because Sunday was such a powerful Sunday. The home group when I was there was powerful. But the rest of the time when I'm out there, where it counts, where Jesus sent us to, nothing is happening. I look like a hunter in the veld with all the camouflage. Not even the kudus see me. The reward for Jesus' death is that we no longer have to fear death, but that we all received eternal life. That is a reward. Do you know that? That's a reward. But we miss it because there's other rewards that we're looking forward to. If I do this, the first reward that we received was God's love. The second reward is eternal life because of what Jesus did, not me. This is the reason why Paul encourages us to stand firm in faith. Stand firm in every trial. Stand firm before every mountain that's in front of you. That's why home groups are so important. If you're not part of a home group, get involved. In home groups, we not just build each other. We don't just encourage each other. We create the environment where we trust each other and we can start speaking about the mountain. We can start speaking about the Red Sea. We can start seeing miracles happening in the home group. But you see, excuses became so easily. It's easier to excuse myself from something than to give an hour or an hour and a half. And I know it's not all of us. But in general, that is how it is. Christians became, people in this house became camouflaged people. The victory is yours. Jesus made sure that the victory is yours. The victories are mine. And in that, there's rewards. God's love for you is so great. He made sure that nothing, listen to me this morning, nothing except you can separate him from his love. Nothing can separate you from Him looking at you with a father's heart, a caring heart, a loving heart, a father that adores you with our mistakes. He loves us so much. So much so that He prepared a life of abundance for us. So much so that even before we were born, He set aside in His kingdom, in all the monies, all the silver, all the gold that is, He set aside some rewards for you. Can you see that this morning? There's a closet with your name on it. There's a room with your name on it. And in that room, that closet, there's rewards, which is yours. But you see, they're not going to fall from the sky. It's ours already, but there's something that we have to do. I think with that, we can give God a hand. Because of the rewards that He has for us. Paul encourages us to continue the work for the Lord as the work of God will never be worthless. Sometimes we feel like that I'm busy trying to do is worthless. I want to tell you this morning, it's not. If it's for God, it's for the kingdom, it will never be worthless. If that thought comes, quiet, silence that thought. Because the enemy is speaking so loud at you, you can hear him. Nothing that you do for God's kingdom, like the same with nothing that you do inside this house, is worthless. By the work that Jesus did, He attained victory. The work done in His name and in love will produce for you and me victories that you can bank on. I promise you this morning that you can bank on that. And with every victory, there's a reward. With every victory, there's a reward. You see, we sometimes miss the rewards. Because the reward that I've got in mind is not the reward that I receive now. The reward that I've got in mind is maybe a salary increase. Or maybe something, but that is not what God wants us to have or want you to have. That you're rewarded with comes from a father's heart. But it's time that we start seeing the rewards that we receive. I listened to a conversation while in hospital, and a question was raised by one of the ladies. What is the work of the Lord? That's a question that she asked. They had a whole night of spending time talking so loud that you hear actually every word that they speak. So they've got the time to discuss this question. And all of this time, I was awake. And I was listening to, and this really prickled a lot of things. If I have to ask you right now this question, how will you answer it? Can I give you a few answers? It is to share the hope and love of Jesus with others. The good news of being victorious because of what Jesus did for everybody. It is loving God and loving others. Leaving evidence behind of Jesus when you leave that person that you just spoke to. That person that you just spoke to not only saw, but he not only heard, but that he experienced something about Jesus. That is part of the work of the Lord. Nowhere in that conversation, not once in that conversation, not in this that I've given you now, not once was a pastor mentioned. It is us, you and me, that ought to do that. You see, pastor here on Sunday, prophet on Sunday, is equipping us for the week to come. But the work to be done is by me and you. Us. May I say, we get to be confident in pursuing the work that God has given us because of the victories that Jesus had. The victories that he still has today. Now, how can I say Jesus still has victories today? Of course I can. Because of the victories that you and me have. Those victories is Jesus's. And because we are partakers with him. Because of that, we walk in the victory that he walked in. And we are victorious as he is victorious. Before I continue, answer me this question. What is your biggest obstacle keeping you from walking, from operating, and functioning in this victory that we're speaking of? What is your biggest obstacle? May I share with you something that came to me? Your mind. Your thoughts. Your stinking thinking. You're looking at the mountain. You're looking at the obstacle. You're looking at the sea in front of you. You're listening to the doctor's report instead of you acknowledging the victory that you already received. You're pondering on the issue at hand instead of standing on the word of God, instead of standing on the promises of God. You're opening the door to doubt instead of declaring the good news. Sometimes it's good that we also declare that good news to ourselves. You see, I also have ears. This body has ears. I've got to speak to it. What else can I speak for it to understand correctly if I don't speak and if I don't bring it, the good news? While in hospital, I had to sing for myself to hear again and again. And if I say again and again, I promise you this morning again and again the song. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Not because it's a great song. Not at all. But I had to silence the thoughts that filled my heart. I had to silence the thoughts so that I can fill my spirit with the truth of who he is. I am blessed, but my head was shouting differently. I am called, but I did not feel like it while in that hospital bed. I am healed, but my body felt like it's falling apart. I am whole, but it felt like I'm broken into pieces. I am saved in Jesus' name. Highly favored, anointed, filled with the power. Yet I felt powerless. I felt useless for the glory of Jesus' name. I had to start speaking the truths over myself. I had to start declaring the truths over myself. I had to declare that I am healed. I had to declare that I am favored. I had to declare that I am blessed. Because my head was leading me to believe otherwise. And because I started to walk in the victory, I was rewarded. The reward for me, getting better and better every day. You see, I could have, after all of this, I could have had the picture in mind that with my believing, my faith in Jesus, I'll get out of hospital and I'm 100% fine. The reward that God is giving me is a daily reward of you getting better. You getting stronger. Does not Does that mean that I feel good every day now? No pain anymore? No negative effects from the chemo that I have daily? No. No, not at all. But I declare my victories because I partake in Jesus' victories. When you start declaring and when you start walking in His victories, you become part of His victories. And can I tell you something? There's a world out there that's waiting for me and for you to speak something that they can understand and that they want by telling them what Jesus did for you. Is it over yet? No. But I'm on the right course. I can already see the end. I can already see that I'm 100%, 100%, not 90, 100%. And then we start getting the attention of the people at your workplace. Matthew 4, verse 18 and 19. As he was walking by the Sea of Galilee, he noticed two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, throwing a dragnet into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Come after me, as disciples, letting me be your guide, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men." Can you see the picture? Can you see the picture? You know what I'm seeing? I'm seeing Jesus there on the beach, taking a walk. Looking at the beach, looking at the sea, looking at the children enjoying their time on the beach. He's enjoying what God has placed around him. I think sometimes even a smile on his face with the naughty kids. But he's walking there not just because he's enjoying. He's out there on a mission. Jesus is out there on a mission to have the work done his father called him to do. So although he's enjoying, he's out there on a mission. Michelle is always saying, and I know I'm going to have a slap or two for this one, but Michelle is saying, like last week Sunday, the seat is getting so warm that she's got to stand. The seat where she sits is getting so warm that she's got to go and do something. Or the seat is getting so warm that she's got to get up and grab a flag and come by the flag. You've got to get up. To do the work that God has given us to do, we've got to get up. Jesus needed people in this work that God has given him. Normal, everyday people like you and me. He needed people to work with him. And he started calling his disciples. He was commanding them to follow him, to learn from him, so that he can enable them to do the work, to equip them sufficiently to do the work. Today, Jesus is seated at the right hand of God. We have Holy Spirit that took that place. We have Holy Spirit that wants to lead us and guide us, to teach us. He wants us to be His disciples. Do you agree with me? A disciple is somebody learning. So as long as we're learning, we ought to be disciples of Him, teaching us. We have to have teachable hearts. We have to have teachable characters. This morning, Holy Spirit is the one that says to you, follow me. He is the one that teaches us. He is the one that we ought to listen to. The party that we ought to listen to. The party that we belong to. He is the one making the seat warm where you are sitting on. It's no longer about your wants. It's no longer about your needs. It's all about Him that Jesus gave us to guide us, to teach us. And Jesus did that so that we have a counselor. Jesus did that so that we have a helper, that we have a friend here on earth. You know that you can call him your friend. And I think that's one of his biggest desires is for you to call him my friend. If you speak to him, we're not speaking to a distance person. We're speaking to somebody in here. And I think he wants us to say, my friend, Holy Spirit, my friend. To follow his lead, to imitate his love, to make known the works that he's busy doing in you and through you. You see, that the Holy Spirit is busy doing inside of us, nobody will know about that work if I don't tell somebody about it. Nobody will see that works if I don't show the works. So if nobody sees and nobody hears, nobody, how can I then say there's a reward for me? How many times did the Holy Spirit speak to you about the little faith? How many times before did he speak to you about the room that you give for doubt in your heart? Telling you, trust me. Trust in me. Trust my ways. Trust my leading. Trust that what I'm busy showing you, that what I'm busy saying to you, trust it. How many times before did he say that to you and me? Just like Jesus. He wants us to believe in him. He wants us to put all our faith in him. He wants us. May I use the word, haak arm in, saam met my. Kom loop saam met my. I don't see him walking by himself. Because if he's walking by himself, there's an issue, there's a problem. Because you're not there. Then it means we separated. And we cannot be separated. Because if we're separated, there's no reward. Holy Spirit rewards me and you, just like the disciples were rewarded. He allows us to walk the walk of faith. He helps us to be able to multiply the bread and give water to the hungry and the thirst. He helps us by showing us how to serve people, how to serve in the house. He's giving us every day, every single day, he's giving us the power to go out and bring the good news, to heal the sick, to raise the dead, with the same commandment that Jesus gave. You and me ought to go out. Something that came to me when I was busy with this. You know what's the difference in many cases? Being visible. Being visible. You see, at work, the people is pointing fingers and they're talking behind your back because you're visible. The bosses is giving you a hard time because you are visible. You know, things is getting difficult because you're visible. If you were not visible, it would have been a different story. But because you are visible, because you're showing Jesus, people don't like it. People will talk behind your back. People will give you a hard time. But I want to say to you this morning, stand on what you know. He will never forsake you and he will never leave you. He will always be with you. That's a reward, do you know that? That's what Jesus taught the disciples. Holy Spirit is teaching us today. Just like Jesus gave power and abilities to the disciples, we receive power and abilities from the Holy Spirit. Let's just be honest with ourselves. We are powerless and we are without abilities when we are on our own. When there's no union, when there's no communion, when there's no friendship, when there's no relationship, it means you're on your own. You cannot expect to be powerful. And you cannot expect to have abilities. This last number of Sundays, some of us had the privilege to bring word on the gifts of Jesus, the gifts of God, the gifts of Holy Spirit. The gifts of Holy Spirit, God will not take away from us. But because that was a reward. But we start functioning in it less and less and less. The disciples were rewarded. So are we. When we adhere to the Holy Spirit, when we follow and learn from Him, when people look at us, they see, they hear and they feel that we might be in this world. But we're not from this world. We might be in the circumstances, but the circumstances is not bigger than me. The mountain might stand in front of you, but the one standing inside of you, the power inside of you, is bigger than the mountain. But how do we look at it? You see, it's easy now to say yes, amen. Believe me. It's easy now to say amen. But when you're there, it's different. When you're there, it's different. That's why, as a family, we ought to come together frequently. That's why we cannot neglect home groups. That's why prayer groups are so important. Because when you're on your own, the mountain does look bigger. When you're on your own, the circumstances look like it's going to swallow me up. When we bring hope to the hopeless, when we give food and clothing to the poor, when we bring light to the ones caught up in darkness, when we speak a word of encouragement and give love to the lost. That's part of the reward that we receive, that we have to give to somebody. But this we can only do when we are devoted disciples of Holy Spirit. Loving Him, doing as He teaches us, and as He guides us. Listen to Song of Solomon 5 verse 15. It says, He is steadfast. He, that's Jesus, He is steadfast in all He does. His ways are the ways of the righteousness, of righteousness, based on truth and holiness. None can rival Him. But all will be amazed by Him. That's nice. All will be amazed by Him. You know why many people is not amazed by Jesus? Because we're not showing it anymore. Because we're living lives that looks like camouflage. Blend in. I don't want to stand out. Because the saying is that the tallest tree catches the wind. So I don't want to stand out. I don't want to catch the winds. How else are we going to show the world how amazing the lover of our life is? If we keep quiet. Does not matter how big the situation, or how deep the valley, or how high the mountain is. Holy Spirit never wavers under pressure. Never. Holy Spirit will never. He is steady and constant. He is stable and reliable. And because He is that, He wants to make you steady and constant. He wants you to be stable and reliable. But again, there's a choice. We can either want it And then how much of that do I want? Do I just want to stand for 5 minutes this morning while everybody's gathering and then I'll be fine? Because then I only need a little bit. But if I want to stand every moment of the day, I need a lot. So how much are you taking? Everything he does is based on God's purity, on God's holiness, and on God's truth. Nothing else. Doesn't matter what he speaks to you, doesn't matter what he shows you, doesn't matter where he's leading you. This is what everything is based on that he's busy teaching us. His ways are always executed with strength and with power. Holy Spirit will not, never ever fail his tasks. May I say something this morning? Neither will he fail you. If you keep on to him, if you keep on holding on to him, if you keep on obeying and loving him, he will never fail you. This speaks of steadfast. And because he is steadfast, he is busy teaching you and me to be steadfast. When you become steadfast and you grow in being steadfast, you yourself become like a marble pillar established upon a foundation of righteousness laid by Jesus. I underlined this because I just felt this morning when I got up, I need to say this to somebody this morning. You being planted on the foundation was not a mistake. You being groomed to be steadfast is not a mistake. You were handpicked, and no person can compare to you. Nobody. Because you're unique. You were a special design by God. You are unique. Jesus pursues you because he loves you. He knows that you need him to stand firm, to be steadfast. That is why he gave us Holy Spirit. Nothing, not the times that you had fallen and you felt like, I don't want to get up. Not the times that you doubted, or the times that you felt that you failed God so much, will ever make him change his mind about you and his love for you. He is constant. He is steadfast. He loves you. He is the rock of all ages, the foundation. If I look at all of that, it says something to me that God is committed to me. Now I want to ask myself a question this morning. How committed am I to God? You see, God is committed through everything. He's committed to me and you. And he's only asking for 10%. 10% of my time. 10% of the time at work. 10%. How committed is, because it should actually be, I'll take 10% of the day for myself. The rest of the 90% of the day, I'll promote God in it. The 90% of my day, I will show him, the people around me, who Jesus is. People will hear him talk. People will see him in action. People will see the rewards coming my way in the 90% that I give God. But we're struggling with 10%. May I share something with you? Holy Spirit is so compassionate about you. He is so compassionate about you. He's committed to you. Holy Spirit will tirelessly continue to encourage you when you are weary. When you feel not strong. When you feel he's there. And he celebrates even in the smallest of your victories. Do you believe that? He celebrates even in the smallest of your victories. The things that you thought you cannot overcome. And you do that because of you being steadfast. He celebrates. I can see him jumping up and down. Yes. He did it. He did it. He wants to be your strength. He wants to be your foundation. He wants to be the source of your joy. He is joy. But how many of us show joy at work? How many of us show the ones around us what joy looks like? Even sometimes here in church, and I'm sorry to say it this morning, even sometimes here in this morning and at church, when people walks in, I sometimes think to myself, why did they leave the joy in the car? It should actually must come with. You shouldn't leave the joy somewhere else. Because we are all so serious. So serious that we lost the joy. He's the source of our joy. How can we say we lost the joy? We neglect the joy. Yeah? He wants to reward you. Believe you me when I say that. He wants to reward you even for the smallest of the smallest victories in your life. And when you stand steadfast, whatever it is that you're going through or that you are facing, people look at you. People see your faith. People see how you endure. People listen to your speech and they take very well note of your vocabulary. That's the tongue slip. And because of how you do, because of your speech, because of you being an example of who Jesus is, of God's love, of God's caring, of God's forgiveness, you get rewarded. Your name are added to a list of names that will also receive a reward one day, a special reward someday when we're in heaven, when we're there. But for now, we are rewarded every day. It's not a one-day thing. Do you have a friend? And I'm speaking to everybody. Do you have a friend that's pushing you? Do you have a friend that's really caring? Do you have a friend that when he sees that you are busy on the right track, that sets you right? Do you have a friend like that who will correct you in your words? Who will correct you when your walk and your faith is not the same? Do you have a friend like that? I have. I want to say to you this morning, that is a gift that you received from God. Be grateful for that friend, because I've got a friend like that. I've got friends like that, that's willing to put everything down and say, Cobus, word wakker. Cobus, you're not at the right place right now. Get your head out of the pit. That is a friend indeed. Can I tell you something? That's a reward. How many of us have rewards like this? I've got, if I had 10 hands right now, but I've got rewards like that. And I can call them a friend. I can call them a friend. Let's be grateful for friends like that, that the Lord is giving us. I want to share something with you this morning. But if you're going to excuse me, if you're going to forgive me, whatever, I'm going to sit down now. I want to share something with you this morning that was given to me. But I want to say something to you this morning. This is for each and every one of us. This is in season. How many times do we sit in church and somebody, prophet, is giving a prophecy, a word to a person? How many of us is taking in what that person is busy receiving? You see, the majority of us, the moment that Cobus received a word when he's sitting at the back. That word is for Cobus. So I'm busy with something else. Can I tell you something? Prophecy were given to us to build the house. So maybe the whole of that word is not for you. But you know what? Much from that you can take. You can take that to encourage yourself. You can take that to build yourself. You can take that and decide with that. I'm so eager with what he received now. I'm going to build with him. That's what prophecy is about. But the majority of Christians came to a place when Cobus receives a word, that's for him. Hallelujah. He's got a word. On Sunday, I said to Michelle afterwards, I was crying there at the back. I was crying. Because God is so special that he picked me on Sunday to give a word. But the word that I received on Sunday is for each and every one of us. How hungry are we? That's the question. How hungry are we? I'm going to make my way up, but as I'm going there, this is something that I want to share with everybody this morning. So I want everybody to listen with me. Instead of using up your reserve power to dodge enemy firing darts or look for a new solution, the Lord would simply have you hold your ground. Meaning, you being steadfast. It's not just about holding on. It's about standing firm. Jesus has already spoken. Stand on his word. Stand on his promises. Don't let your mind speak to you. You start speaking to your mind. You start speaking to your body. You start speaking to the circumstances. I started by saying it's got ears. When it's got ears, speak to it. Worries rob you from being steadfast. It also robs you from your victories. It's robbing you from your rewards. You know, the word says that he's out there to steal and destroy. What does he steal? Our health? Wealth? Yes. He also steals our rewards. It's time that we say enough is enough. I'm not giving away my rewards anymore. I will start fighting for my rewards. And God will give you more friends that will back you. More friends that will show you, Cobus. No. Martins, yeah. That's what God wants to do. Never think that that you face the storm or the mountain all by yourself. Never. Holy Spirit is with you. He's with you every moment. Even while sometimes you don't feel him, even sometimes when you don't hear him. Can I tell you why we're not hearing and feeling him, why we're not seeing him? Because we're in another place. There where he is where we ought to be. He will never stop being our comforter, and he will never stop being our strengthener. He will never stop being your friend. Never. As you stand firm and endure to the finish, you will not only be victorious, you will be rewarded. Growing your roots of faith will ask from you to stand strong and stand tall, being visible, standing out. Our greatest setbacks and our greatest challenges often come before the biggest of our breakthroughs. You see, but sometimes there's testing areas. Sometimes there's testing times. So you can test yourself. Am I going to get the reward? or am I going to forfeit the reward? In any, with the Olympics now, in any sports, the comrades that was not long back, any other sport, do you know of any sport where a person receives a medal or a prize for not finishing the race? There's no such sport. But in our faith walk, in our walk here as sons and daughters of God, why do we want that to be different? We cannot have a different. If we're not going to finish the race, we're not going to have a reward. If you're not going to do something, you're not going to have a reward. Determine that you are a breaker. You have to make it out for yourself. It is like you choosing life or death. Make up your mind and choose to be victorious. Make up your mind and choose to be rewarded, to walk in victory. Embrace the season of standing and look for the new rewards coming your way. I honestly, you know, we say God is, everything belongs to God. Everything is His. Why will God then give us the old rewards? God is moving forward. Sometimes we stand still. And when we stand still, we cannot be rewarded. But if we start moving with God, God is not going to take the oldest of the oldest rewards and give that to us. God is giving us fresh, new rewards. Why? So that at our testimony can be fresh and new every day. Let me remind you of what 2 Chronicles 15 verse 7 says to you and me. But as for you, each one of us, be strong and do not give up, for your work will be rewarded. Ooh. Don't give up. Do what you have to do. Do what is good, and you will be rewarded. That's a promise. That's a promise. God is no man that He will lie. That's a promise to you and me. Can you think of a time recently where something that you went through, something that you faced, something in the family, does not matter, was so hard that you just felt like giving up? That was so difficult that you thought, I can't anymore. But you didn't. Where did you get the strength from? What kept you going? Think about it. The strength that you had to endure, to go through, to be steadfast. Where did you get that? That's not from yourself, because from ourselves we cannot. From ourselves we do, like the world is doing, run to the bottle store. Grab something that will help me calm this storm till tomorrow morning. Tomorrow morning is another day. Tomorrow morning is another day. We'll sort tomorrow out. For right now, I just need something to get me through now. Can I tell you the reward that we've got is to endure each and every one so that we can go through and be a testimony of who God is, of His love. Will you repeat after me? By my endurance, I will gain the reward. The reward for my steadfastness.
Wow.
That did not sound very encouraging. Can we try again? By my endurance, I will gain the reward. The reward for my steadfastness. Yes. Okay, now let's personalize this a little bit. Put in your name. By my Cobus endurance, by my endurance, I will be rewarded. The reward for my steadfastness. If you believe what you just said now, because that is something that you prophesied over yourself now. If you believe what you said now, I want you to say amen on that.
Amen.
Yes. I'm going to ask my lovely wife, Michelle, to come and sit here with me. I've asked her to. Sometimes, Prophet will tell you, sometimes this place here in the front is a lonely place. So when you get the chance to get somebody close to come and sit with you, when I said to her, she said to me, "No, what will you know, Vere?" I just said to her, "Listen, just follow my lead." I want to share something with you, and I'm going to read most of it. It's called A Breaker's Reward for Those Who Stay Standing. It's a prophetic word by Wanda Alger. She starts with, "This is a word for everyone who is weary and keeping up the good fight. You've been in a constant survival mode and feeling depleted of any spiritual grit or passion. You're beginning to wonder what you've been doing wrong. Perhaps you thought you need to pray more, even fast more, or discover some new strategy for combating the endless attacks and the endless waves against your wealth, against your health, and your well-being. You've probably entertained feelings of failure and even wondered if you're disappointing God because of your seemingly inability to overcome the distractions and the setbacks. But instead of beating yourself up for not being more spiritual, mature, or zealous in the fight that you're fighting, take another look. Consider other perspectives. Consider the power that you carry within you. When you simply determine not to back down from what God has already said. Consider the possibility that instead of losing the battle, you are actually busy winning the battle. Welcome to the season of standing. I believe many are in this season right now, a time when the Lord is teaching us, you and me, about endurance, about the power of simply standing and not bending to opposing forces, about breaking through and winning the battles because you simply won't yield. And it's not because that you're fighting well. It's because you're standing well. When we read in Ephesians 6 verse 13, having done all, stand. Going through the Red Sea that you're busy going through, stand. The circumstances, stand. Whatever it is that you find yourself in now, stand. This is not some last ditch effort to simply just hang on. It's not a last resort of our battle strategy. Or plan C for those who just don't have the spiritual nerve and muscle to keep wielding the sword against the enemy forces. I don't think that is what God had in mind, because He knows something that most of us don't. God knows something that most of you don't, because there's a lack in the relationship. There's a lack in your zeal for Him. There's a lack in your time for Him. He knows the inherent strength of endurance. He knows the increased authority we gain in the Spirit when we refuse to step back from His promises and simply stand firm. Endurance is not for the faint of heart. Endurance is a powerful weapon against the enemy when we embrace the invitation of that. Remember, the enemy can't immobilize us. If the enemy can't immobilize us through fear, He'll just try to wear us out, to make us tired. Hoping to siphon out every last ounce of hope and of the promises, he'll throw endless curveballs to make us second guess God's word and his promises. Is that really so? Am I really healed? Can I really stand on the word that I received? You see, that's the things that's happening the moment that we back off from standing firm. He'll turn up the volume of lies and threats and drain us of all our energy and support. He'll do anything to make us give up and give in. I want to say to you this morning, I want to encourage you this morning, don't give up. Don't give in. Don't allow him to speak to you. Tell him to shut up. Don't allow the devil to speak to you. You command him. Jesus did not allow him to finish his whole thing. Jesus commanded him, but the word said. It is written in the word. But the Lord God helps me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I will set my face like a flint, and I know that I shall not be put to shame. Isaiah 50 verse 7. Instead of us using up our reserve power to dodge enemy fires or look for new solutions, the Lord would simply have you hold your ground. Do not budge from your position of faith. He has already spoken. Stand on his word. Don't change your mind and don't cave in to the pressures of the world, the pressure of the enemy. Don't waste your time worrying about the unexpected twists and turns from enemy forces. Set your face like a flint. Can you see that picture? Set your face like a flint. That's something that you decide to do. Set your face like a flint and refuse to cave in to the unending waves, the unending storms. As you stand firm and endure to the finish, you will become an immovable fortress against your enemies and a victor in making. You see, we are growing in this walk of victories. It's not that it's a once of victory. There's victory upon victory. There's a reward upon reward. But if we back down, we're going to miss it. Your roots of faith will grow deeper into the soil of your future, preparing your way for a breaker's reward. I want to say this again. Your greatest setbacks and challenges often come right before the biggest breakthroughs that you've seen. Determine that you are a breaker. Embrace the season of standing and look forward to the next victory. Look forward to the next reward. You see, if it's not something that I long for, it's not something that I want, I'm not going to get it. But when I start looking forward, when I'm eager, I will receive. I will walk in that victory and I will receive the reward for that. By your endurance, you will receive the reward. Luke 21 verse 19 says, by your steadfastness and patient endurance, you shall win the true life of your souls. You shall. You shall. It's a promise. The reward is yours. The reward comes when you are spending time in God's word, like a gold digger. He does not stop till he hits bedrock, because that's where the gold is. That's where the prize is. That's how we ought to be in God's word. Don't stop until I've got the first nugget. The first nugget makes me so hungry, so desperate for the next one, that I continue digging. The only difference between a bedrock with gold and God's word, there's no end. There's no depth to God's word. You see, we see how deep it is. But the moment that we're going deeper, it becomes deeper. And it goes deeper and deeper. In prayer, for others, for the house. You see, many of us, prophet is saying so many times, I've tried it once, I will never do it again. Tape yourself when you pray. Make sure you're on your own. Tape yourself when you pray. And after that, listen to the selfish prayer that you prayed. And being visible tomorrow. Showing Jesus alive to a dead world. Be steadfast and do so with a grateful heart in faith. In 1 Corinthians 9:24-25, Paul speaks of a race where all runners compete for a medal, but only the winners will receive a medal. They are rewarded for the time that they've put in for the race. They are rewarded for eating correctly. They are rewarded for sleeping. They are rewarded for giving their best to finish the race. The problem for many is we want that reward in a 5-minute relationship. Whether it's in the morning or in the evening, doesn't matter. We want that reward, but we're willing to give only five minutes. Many, many mornings, there is not even a 5 minutes because we overslept, and on my way to work, I'll quickly have a prayer. Your mind is so far from God that prayer is even more selfish. Doing the work of the Lord must become a lifestyle to you, meaning you invest all. You give everything. You do all that God called you for, sharing the good news, sharing His love, sharing Him with the world. Standing out, standing firm, and you shall be rewarded. You will receive the reward. The word is very clear on that. God is no man that He will tell us something and do differently. God is no man that He will lie about anything that He's placed in His word for us. The reward is yours. Amen. Father, we're privileged this morning. I'm privileged this morning, Lord, to sit down and share your message. A message of not just hope to each and every one of us. A message, Lord, this morning that speaks of so much that we've lost in rewards. Because many of us had looked at the reward differently. Many of us was looking for a different reward instead that you've given us. And we missed it. But this morning, Lord, as Jesus is walking on the beach and He's looking at everything, the mission that He has is to complete your work. Lord, help us, each and every one of us, so that same mission, that same vision, that same heart will be that of Jesus, to do the work that you've given us to do tomorrow. Lord, that we will bring something, a different flavor, a different outlook into a world, Lord, that looks dead. Like the country is looking right now, the countryside, Lord, there's no green grass because it's winter. Everything looks dead. That's how the world is looking. But when you drive past a land and there's a green patch for whatever it is, Lord, everybody take notice of that as they're driving past it, because it's looking differently. It's looking beautiful. It's looking, something else is happening there. That's why it's looking differently. Lord, when the world look at many of your children, they don't see that in us. Lord, this morning, forgive us because so many of us, Lord, started to look like the world instead of being visible. So many of us, Lord, became owners of camouflage companies instead of parting with your party. Lord, I'm grateful for a message like this morning because there's hope. You are our hope. And in this, Lord, you come this morning and you show to us that that we're busy doing for you, our love for you, our hearts for you, our speech of who you are, what you've done, Lord, our testimony will never be worthless. You're rewarding us each and every time. Thank you, Lord, that you reward us with this family. Thank you, Lord, that part of this reward that we have is this house of ours. A beautiful house. A strong house. A house that ought to go into this town, Lord, and make a difference. I pray, Lord, that you will give us the same mindset of Jesus. That we will start going out and look at things differently. Lord, that we will look at things the way Jesus looked at it. That we will be the light in the darkness for many. That we will be able, Lord, to give to the poor, to look after the orphans and the widows, that we will be able to share you with the world out there. And when they hear us and when they see us, that they will recognize this is not Cobus. This is something inside of him, greater than him, that he's just busy carrying and that he's busy opening up for us to see. And that is my prayer, Lord, for each and every one of us, that you will be noticed, that you will be seen, that you will be here in and through us, our deeds, our words, our vocabulary. And I pray you that this morning, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you, everybody. It was awesome to have you here this morning. Have a good afternoon. Like Prophet always say, that leg of lamb in the oven, go and enjoy it. And we'll be back tonight at 6. God bless you and be safe. And remember next week, Sunday morning, when Pastor Jan is here, let's come with the mindset of blessing them. Can we do that? Yes. Amen. Thank you. Yes, kom ek aan die bewe toe, ek hier met die trappe opkom. Kom ek aan die bewe toe, ek hier met die trappe opkom.